Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Cape Rugby TV, of course. And as we say every Wednesday, welcome and nice to have you along. Before we get into the Varsity Cup, the Community Challenge, and of course it was a Super 15 this weekend, let me introduce you to my panel, the regular panel, finally back. The boys are back. Morgan Newman.
How's it, Japs? Good to be back on the show. Yeah, good. Thanks for the introduction.
I see you smiling from ear to ear.
Yeah, look, Super 15 is back up and running, so my Friday mornings are not as gloomy anymore. And yeah, it's good rugby on display.
I know. These sad, gloomy Friday mornings. Ish, you don't have gloomy Friday mornings, huh?
No, I'm up always very early, but good to be back. Nice to have Captain Morgan here on my right-hand side again. We're just missing Paul Delport.
Yeah, Paul Delport, you know, I don't think he's going to be the same man ever again. I believe he's a changed man now, so, but you know, every man at some other stage has to bite the bullet and go down.
We'll get him back.
Morgs, yeah. You seem to be enjoying the moment.
Yeah, I know where you're heading with that one. It was his bachelor's and he's getting married pretty soon, so yeah, I think he's a changed man for life, so he's put a ring on it, and let's see what happens.
No, well done, Paulie. If you're watching us right now, we wish you the very best, and I'm sure that your other half is a very, very lucky woman to have landed a Super Sevens Springbok and, of course, a Cape Rugby TV presenter. So, you know, not a lot of women out there can say that they've managed to hook up with a Cape Rugby TV presenter. Ish, I mean, you agree with me?
I don't think my wife would agree.
Morgan walks around though with that sign. Anyway,
yeah, no, it's a tag. I'm happy to carry around with me.
it is. I noticed when you were at Caprice the other night, they had the Cape Rugby TV show up on the plasma.
Yeah, I know. When you head down to the and when the repeats are playing, and you happen to be in the. Happy to having a sort of a chilled, relaxing drink, and they happen to play these things. So, yeah, I get a little bit of flack, but it's all good.
I mean, I was quite impressed when they switched the Bundesliga on to watch the Cape Rugby TV Liga. Anyway, folks, yes, of course, back to serious stuff now. Rugby, community rugby. And this is what we live for, all right? Doesn't matter what else happens out there. The one thing that you can absolutely be guaranteed is that the clubs will play. And I've kind of come onto this thing now that, rugby is rugby, but club rugby is the people's sport. I don't know. Ish, how do you feel about that?
Definitely. Fully agree. Molniton played Makassar over the weekend.
And yeah, Friday night. Eh?
Friday night. And the geus at Makassar was absolutely superb. The entertainment, the welcoming from the host was absolutely brilliant. And you can just see that the people, they just cannot wait for club rugby to start.
Yeah, no, I was out at Belleville over the weekend. I went to go watch Scottsdene play Belleville. I was hoping to get to your game on the Friday night, but I was stuck in a very, very long council meeting. Because I knew that you guys had that little friendly against Makassar. And Makassar is definitely one of those clubs that loves watching Cape Rugby. So I'm sure that there were probably a few people who... Did they have a chirp?
No, I mean, they were just up for the game and the welcoming, as I said. Yeah. I mean, there was probably about 1,000 people just watching the game. And to see that amount of people and the cheers, it's unbelievable. I mean, they cannot wait for the season to start, as I said.
I was thinking, you know, no disrespect to anybody, but... professional sport is the fans' game. Amateur sport is the people's game.
It's the community game. And that's what it's all about. I mean, when you see guys brying on the one side and the music playing from the guy's car, and it's just all part of
it. And
it
doesn't really matter. Win or lose, no, there's no question. People are going to be back. They're going to keep doing it. You know, I think we're doing the best sport out.
And people are enjoying themselves. I mean, it's been a hard week for everyone. Yeah. And everyone would just like to come down and just... you know, let it all out and just come watch some rugby.
Yeah, and that it is absolutely fantastic. Folks, anyway, those were our little moments over the weekend. And I think we put something on Facebook as well, just saying how lekker it was to get down. And it was quite impressive to note that already the club rugby fever is starting to build. I know we've had some Varsity Cup. We've had a little taste of the Community Cup. And, of course, the Super 15 has now started. And, of course, we had a lot of sevens. And, in fact, I think in the sevens rugby over the last couple of weeks, we had more of a taste of community rugby than we had in the other form. So we've already got a taste of club rugby just by watching the clubs that have been playing sevens.
Yeah, people are hungry for rugby, you know. I think the festive season has come and gone, and now it's time for rugby, you know, and to see all the different clubs from all over the Western Cape come together to one field to play sevens. A lot of, you know, sort of action-packed, a lot of lot of action. And yeah. And, I mean, and it's funny to see that the guys who were supporting Hands and Hearts in the one game are all of a sudden supporting Scotland in the other game. And then Cape Rugby TV team players, and then they're supporting them. So I think it creates a good camaraderie and chaos amongst the community when it comes to club rugby in the Western Cape.
Yeah, and I had some moron on Twitter from the West Coast say, club rugby's dying. You know, although I think he was referring to some other rugby, but I thought, here's a guy who says club rugby's dying. He probably has never been to a club rugby game, because if he had to go down to Belleville, or come down to the Strand Pioneers, or come down to Macassar against Molniton, I mean, there's no way you're going to say club rugby's dying.
I think he's on a different planet. Yeah. He's on the West Coast.
He's on the West Coast. It is almost a different planet, but we do have our West Coast. But it's not strictly speaking in the West Coast district. We've got our Vescas Mensa that are up there, Atlantis and Mamre. We know you guys are watching, and we love your support. So don't go too far north that you're like all the way up to, I don't know, Swakopmund Sakante. Let's take a look now at the results from the Varsity Shield and, of course, the Varsity Cup. And the Shield there, it was CUT going down 31-29 to Fort Hare, while UKZN went down to TUT 39 points to 18. In the Varsity Cup, we see UCT going down to Tux 26-16. Shimla's beating FNB UJ 52-16. Marty's beating Wits 18 points to 15. And then, of course, MMMU, well, they went down to Pukka, 52 points to 16. I suppose there are... Okay, let's start off with the Varsity Shield results there, guys. CUT, they have proven to be a strong team, but they went down to Fort Hare. Fort Hare hasn't had the greatest of starts to the Varsity Cup, but nevertheless, they look like they're getting stronger as they go along.
Yeah, they definitely are getting stronger. You know, I thought the likes of John Mitchell there at Fort Hare would have had a little bit more to say about... you know, about the result. But yeah, I mean, you know, the TUT are showing that CUT are showing that they the log leaders for a reason. And you know, UWC was so widely spoken about, happened to have a bye, so hoping they can turn it around this coming Thursday.
Yeah, well, I mean, they're all sort of in the coastal region, so I think what you mean with John Mitchell is, you know, obviously he's with the MP.
I mean,
but I know what you mean, because they're helping each other, and he's been extending his support to the other teams out in that space. So he won't be happy with that kind of result. He'd be wanting those teams, because I know that they're all kind of knocking each other's doors, asking for advice. And a guy like Mitchell is just a wizard in the world of rugby.
Yeah, I think a lot of teams are taking a leaf out of the UWC hat in terms of getting Peter de Villiers on board. I know a lot of the Varsity Cup has become such a widely spoken about competition now, that I think they're drawing a lot of support and guidance from the senior coaches, because it's become a tournament where, you know, tactician and all these kind of things come into play a massive role. So it's good to see, and the quality of rugby is really good.
Massively involved now.
Yeah, I think it's the Varsity Cup has overtaken sort of the Vodacom Cup. Vodacom Cup has taken a bit of a backstep. And as you said, UWC drawing on the likes of Peter de Villiers, John Mitchell, these are all big names, and Jonathan Kaplan as well, he's involved in at UCT. So we can see that the Varsity Cup is becoming sort of the way forward in terms of rugby and amateur rugby in the leagues of South Africa.
Well, I don't know. I hope it's not too much of the way forward, because it's only for universities.
Yeah, well, we've got the Community Cup and we've got the Community Challenge, and as well as Western Province Club Rugby. So there's plenty of rugby, just as a way forward in terms of taking that biggest step from school into university, into the professional ranks.
Okay, so let me ask you this then. Which league or competition should you be the proudest to play in? The Community Cup, the Community Challenge, the Varsity Cup, or normal club rugby league?
Look, I think each league, and now I might speak, but I think each league caters for a different
market.
Player or market, if you want to call it that. Yeah. So if you look at the Varsity Cup, it caters for guys who are privileged enough to go through university and try and make a rugby career that way. You look at the Community Cup, it caters for someone that has maybe didn't make it during the varsity, has maybe a late bloomer in terms of rugby, you know, and has joined a club outside of the university that he feels he can play for, and he can find his way into a professional setup that way. You look at the Community Challenge, on the other hand, is again, it's a guy who maybe wants to stay in his community and play for his community and be seen and make a career that way. So if I look at it from a personal point of view, I think each competition caters for a different market, and I think it's extremely good in South Africa, because everywhere else in the world, I think, you know, there's only one competition you can play in to be seen. Yeah. Now we've got five or six where you can put your hand up and say, listen, have a look at me.
That the Varsity Cup is delivering Springboks. They've got an extremely high rate of Springboks. If you look at the Springboks today, most of them played Varsity Cup at some stage. So, you know, it's a question of, like we said, there is enough rugby to go around, different markets, different aspects, and certainly what the one thing the Varsity Cup does do is it brings entertainment to the people. One way or the other, come Monday night, it is entertainment galore, and that's what the fans want. So if nothing else, that's what we're seeing, is we're seeing a tournament that is designed and specializes in entertainment. So that's the part that I particularly enjoy about the Varsity Cup. And of course, there's a few couple of other interesting dynamics like the different rules and so forth. Anyway, let's go back to the score sheet there quickly. UKZN, of course, going down to TUT. And there we see in the Varsity Cup, UCT going down to Tux. So, Morgs, we had Kevin Musicant on the show. Yeah, he wouldn't be happy with that result there. Going down to Tux, it was home ground advantage for UCT. It's blowing a little bit hot and cold, or is it too early to tell?
Look, I think I think UCT are blowing a little bit hot and cold at the moment. But yeah, look, I happened to watch that game too. It blew a gale down at down the Grootskerk. I mean, it was really, the wind just blew like you won't believe. So, look, really a game of two halves, that old cliche of a game of two halves. But yeah, you got to win your home games in the Varsity Cup, you want to make the playoffs.
All right, folks, let's quickly take a look at some of the photographs from the match between Marties and Wits. Of course, it was an 18 points to 15 win there for Marties. Some nice action pictures for you to take a look at. Nice action shot there, and well done to Marties. That's what they were looking for. They were looking for a victory, and that's exactly what they got. So Marties getting stronger and stronger. Let's take a look now at some of the photographs in the match. UCT against Tux, and sadly for Kevin and, of course, our home team who we support down here, UCT, it just didn't make it. Let's check the action shots. Of great shots there in the Varsity Cup. Remember, of course, it is let's take a look at the logs quickly before we move on to the fixtures, and we'll take a look first at the Varsity Shield. CUT are firmly on top there on 16 points. KZN, the Mighty Impi, on 12, Forte on 11, TUT on 10, and UWC going to have to make a little bit of a comeback, sitting down the bottom in 6th place. And then, of course, in the Varsity Cup, we see Tux on top on 16 points, followed by Pukka on 15, Shimlers on 11, Marties, UCT, NMMU, UJ, and Wits make up the bottom four. Now remember, it is this Thursday that you can get down to UWC. So tomorrow night, come and join us. I'll be on the side of the field there. Come and join us tomorrow night at UWC as they take on UKZN, the Impy, John Mitchell and his boys again. So there'll be a lot of action there. And certainly we know Freddie Miller and his team and Ollie Janssen and Peter de Villiers are going to be looking to bounce back. They haven't had a great run, but we of course had Paul Emanuel on the side on the show last week telling us that they will be looking to up their game. So get down to UWC tomorrow night for the FNB Varsity Cup, which is of course brought to you by Steinhoff and proudly supported by Cell C and The Spur. So tomorrow night it's entertainment galore, kick off at 7 o'clock at UWC. Come down there, come say hello. And by the way, if you are in the stands at UWC, you can take those selfies and you can tweet them to at UWC Online, which is the UWC Twitter handle, and you get an opportunity for yourself to sit on the pink couch. Now UWC put the pink couch on the side of the field, and I remember that the castle red couch at Newlands. It's a great experience. If you get your selfie out there and you win that competition, you get to sit on the pink couch. They feed you and everything. I think last Monday when I was emceeing at UWC, and I've got a guy who helps me with the MC, his name's Simpiwe, and there were two lovely ladies on the pink couch who had all fruit and fruit juice brought to them for entertainment purposes. And after about 2 minutes, my fellow MC just disappeared. Didn't know where he was. And halfway through the game there, I saw him sitting lovely and enjoying himself on the pink couch.
Fruits of heaven, eh?
Yes, very smart. Yes, enjoying the fruits of heaven, yes. And of course, the other fixture up then, also on Thursday, is UWC. At least UWC takes on CUT, but Fort Hare take on KZN. So sorry, my mistake there. It's Fort Hare taking on KZN, John Mitchell's side. And then UWC take on CUT. They'll be down here. Yeah, that's where I was getting my wires crossed, because I realized we had Mitchell and his team down here just the other day. So while I was reading that fixture, which I did by mistake, it was sort of sitting in my brain somewhere that John Mitchell had been down here recently. And as I said, he is now coaching the UKZN team. Then, of course, in the Varsity Cup, in the second round fixtures there on Monday, we see Wits taking on MMU. UJ take on UCT. That's at playing in Johannesburg at 7 o'clock. And then Tuks take on Pika in Pretoria at 7. And then Marty's have got home ground advantage against the Shimlas. That's going to be a cracker of the match. So make sure on Monday night you get down to watch Marty's take on Shimlas. Home ground advantage for Marty. So once again, the Craven Stadium will be absolutely packed for the FNB Varsity Cup, proudly presented by Steinhoff. We'll take an ad break, and when we come back, we'll catch up with some rugby closer to home. And that being, of course, the match Scottsdean against Belleville, which we went out to on Saturday just for entertainment purposes. We'll catch you after the break. So as I said, we went down to Belleville over the weekend. I loved arriving there and the kids coming out and saying hello, and the kids all knowing that we do Cape Rugby. So it was really great to rock up there. And yeah, of course, it was Belleville's first game. They've only been back in practice for 7 days. In fact, it was less than 7 days. They only started practice, I think, on the Monday or the Tuesday. The team there was captained by Maxwell Stoffels, and I think Maxwell's got great leadership skills. So it was one of those games, and a little bit like the Stormers. I thought that some of the comments that came out on Facebook were a little bit unfair. You don't win the league and you don't win the Super 15 in the first round. It's still got a long way to go. It was a little bit rough for Belleville. Of course, they would have liked to come out with a win there. Scottsdean's had a couple of practices, but they came out and they did really well, considering that they're not in the same league, or in the last few years have not been even close to the same league as Belleville. So both teams, great to get started. Let's catch up with some of the highlights. some nice action there and a couple of nice hard hits. Yeah. You know, what do you think, Ish?
Yeah, for a preseason game, it's quite tough. And for Scott's Dean to beat the 1A team, that's kudos to them.
How much do we read into it at this stage, Morgs?
Look, I think it's early days, and often, you know, when a team from a higher league plays a team from a lower league, then, you know, the one is a little bit more motivated than the other. But, yeah, I mean, look, for Babel, that's not a great result, and I think you can read a little bit into it, but I'm sure Jerome will make sure that doesn't happen again. And I can see that by the hits that's taking place, the Alistair's definitely got a role to play. So Coach Alistair Sigela has definitely got something to do with the physicality of that Scots team.
Yeah. Anyway, talking about Alistair Sigela, of course, you guys played with Alistair for many years. Huh?
Yeah, Alistair was the scrum off with Paul Delport. I was 10, and old Captain Morgan over here on my right-hand side was 12.
Was he captain inside?
No, he wasn't.
He wasn't, though?
No. I'm sure I was.
No.
Okay.
a little bit of rivalry between the boys. But did you guys who captained at that stage?
I think Shanyani Shimangi was the captain.
Oh, Shimi.
So. Yeah.
Shimi, all right.
Shimi was the captain. Rita was there. So yeah, there's a lot of boys that are still in West Bromwich Club Rugby now that played in that.
What team was that? That was
the Vodacom Cup team.
The Vodacom Cup.
2008.
Yeah.
Who's coaching?
Jerome. And Tinus Lanier.
Jerome and Tinus Lanier. Yeah, yeah. I think in the next 2 years later, when did Stanley Robenheimer take over?
Yeah, he took over, I think, 2 years after that.
Yeah. So, yeah.
2010 or something.
We caught up there with Alistair Sigelaar, the coach of Scots DNT. What do you have to say? Right, folks, I'm here with Alistair Sigelaar. He's the coach of Scots DNT. Alistair, warm-up game for you guys. Obviously, these games are important before the league starts.
Yes, of course, JP. I think it's vital to get in as many preparation as possible. We've specifically targeted Balvatec as they play in Super A, and we thought it would be a good challenge for us. Happy with the performance today. Balvatec is a good side, always known for running rugby, and I just want to thank them for the opportunity to play against them once again.
Of course, on a day like today, it's not so much about the results, it's about you guys as a coach. You're trying to see how the players are gelling and how it's going to go forward. So how are you feeling about it?
Yeah, exactly. We started our first pre-season game last week against Coronations, and I felt that today we needed to step up from last week. Last week was an average performance from our side, and I asked for a big step up today, and I think the guys came out and all guns blazing, and I think they made the step up that we asked for.
So what are the kind of things that you'd be working on now in the next? I mean, it's about a month left now before the month or maybe 5 weeks left before the first game. What will you be focusing on now? Fine tuning?
That's exactly what it is, JP. You know, getting the lineouts and scrums and rucks and mauls things and all those things together, and just trying to perfect them. You know, I think we've worked hard specifically on rucks and mauls, and I think it paid off today.
Yeah. Oh, listen, well done, and we look forward to following you guys in the season. It's always great fun watching Scots Dean.
Thanks, JP.
Alistair Sigelaar, Morgs, you have a nickname for Alistair back in the day?
Yeah, he was known as the pit bull, eh? Pitty. He got a very Ricky January style about him, and it's actually, you know, on the one hand, it's so sad to see him coaching now. I think he still had so much to offer playing on the playing field, you know, that it's unfortunate that he's coaching, but he's doing a good job of it, so it's good to see.
He clearly has an ability to coach. I mean, there's not a lot of people can play and coach, you know. I mean, I don't know about you, but Ish, you seem to be getting it right.
I can't play, coach. Not the way I'm looking at the moment.
But I mean, you're going to be able to transfer. You know, it's easy. Yeah. People say, like, I can teach something, but I can't do it. You know, not a lot of professional athletes, when they're finished, actually, they think they can coach, but it's...
It's always a work in progress. Coaching, you learn every single day. I mean, I'm learning every single day. And that's
a work in progress. I mean, really, how long have you been in the professional outfit? Because really, that like phrase, the work in progress. I mean, somebody was saying to me over the weekend about some of the teams who had a poor performance. That coach, he won't have a problem finding the drawing board. he won't, because he knows where it is. He's got to go.
Yeah,
he's going back. All right. Anyway, so yes, it's a work in progress. Give them all credit. All credit is due, and we go back to the drawing board. We've heard all those
cliches. Eh?
Yeah, all those cliches. But you guys, you're professional. Actually, you know how to deal with the media.
You know, when we speak to you and this guy over here, we get used to these kind of cliches.
All right. The other guy that jumped out there was A.B. Croy. A.B. Croy was, of course, the captain of Scots Dean. And I tell you, he's a monster of a man. It kind of looked like a big version of Victor Matfield. Let's catch up there with A.B.
Hey mense, ek sien so by Belville, vandag het Scottsdene vir Belville, kom speel hier so, dis a friendly game, AB Kroy is die kaptein van Scottsdene, en het lyk my, het was a goeie warm-up game vir julle.
Ja, as ek het JP, is die tweede game van die seizoen, gaat a bykie moeilik, couple of young guys in die team, baie jong ookie soek sê, vir my is net dat, ja, ek game, moet a step up ons wees, ons kyk gewoon na die league, is a nieuwe liga vir ons, is a nieuwe uitdaging vir ons, en ons hoop, om ten minste tot die einde van hierdie jaar, tweede of derde lê in die liga.
Maar het lyk dat is een goeie geest daar so by julle.
Ja, as ek sê, die geest is goed. Die ookies is jonk en is baie meer, ek sê, baie meer energie in die team as voorheen, as verlede jaar.
Alistair is nou al 'n paar jaar daar so by julle. Dit lyk my dit skop nou in.
Ja, as ek sê, die vrachter weer af. Ons werk baie hard. En as ek sê, is baie ookies, wil het sommige keer opgeen, maar as ek sê, is die moeite werd om die hele druk in die einde van die dag te leef, vrachter van die plak.
Oké, okay, maar luister, wel gedaan. Ik denk jullie gaan een lekker seizoen hè.
Ik hoop zo, ja.
Here we go.
Ja, so AB Kroy there and tough bugger. A little bit shy for such a big guy. Anyway, I suppose the first time the camera gets you in the spotlight, it can be a little bit daunting. But AB, to you and your team, we wish you guys the very best of luck, and we know you guys are going to have a fantastic season. So Scottsdene are ready to get out there and go guns blazing. But of course, no team is successful without a good administrator, and over the years we've managed to focus on some of the administrators that have done well at club rugby, and one of those administrators is the chairman of Scottsdene, Gerald Brock. Now Gerald is always talking to us at Cab Rugby TV and always telling us to make sure we come down to the Scottsdene games. One of the big games they're going to have this year is Scottsdene against Hands and Hearts. Now that's going to be a monster derby. Now the teams are in the same league, we're going to see some really good derby. So Gerald, we're going to do our very best to come out to you, but of course we first got to try and understand all the fixtures within the league. Let's catch up with Gerald Brock. He tells us about some of the performances and the progression at Scottsdene. I'm here at Belville now. I'm with Gerald Brock. He's the chairman of Scottsdene. It was a warm-up game for you guys, but you had your first one already last week against Stelco. Sponsors came out there. Looks like you guys are off to a good start.
Yeah, we're quite fortunate to have two sponsors in MSC and Gibson's Dubai. They visited last week, and we had a nice game with Coronations, and we did good.
So now how you want to start off in the season. You want to start off with sponsors. You're not so worried about starting off with victories. You want to start off with guys who are going to support you through the season. But the guys from Dubai have been with you for a while now.
Gibson's been with us for 2 years. You know, it's tough work running clubs without finance.
Yeah.
And happily they on board this year again to give us an injection of cash funds, which we are happy and fortunate to receive. Thank you.
Well, listen, Gerald, and that mean, you know, if I look at your spirit and I look at what you guys have done over the last 2-3 years, and you've got the sponsors, that's exactly, and we've said it before, that's exactly how you run a club, so well done.
Okay, thank you so much to Gibson's. I hope they catch DSTV in Dubai. Thank you, Gibson's. We love you.
Well, if they don't get us on DSTV, they can definitely catch us on YouTube, so we'll make sure that they see this interview.
Thank you to JP, Gerald. And thank you, okay. Cape TV. Thank you.
Well done, Gerald. Now, I don't know what Gibson's do, but Gibson's in Dubai is clearly supporting Scottsdene. So, Gibson's, keep up the good work. Thanks for supporting a community team, a true community team. So, I tell you, the folks, the community in Scottsdene, they love Scottsdene, and they certainly need all the support that they can get. So, if you're out there, and we know that Cheslin Colby went to Scottsville, which is just on the road from Scottsdene. Could have been a feeder player to Scottsdene Rugby Club. In fact, I think he might even have played there. But great to see an administrator like that. Morgs, you say he was on the phone to you the next day.
Yeah, no, when he heard he was coming down, he was up in arms. He was so excited about Cape Rugby TV coming down there, and you know, the guys were well looked after. And then, yeah, he mentioned the Scottsdene Hands and Hearts Derby, which he doesn't want us to miss for the world. He's told me to bring my family down and everyone, so I guess if I'm not playing that Friday, Saturday, I'll definitely be down there.
Now, I tell you, that's going to be a monster game. Scottsdene and Hands and Hearts is going to be an absolute cracker. So we'll make sure that we keep you reminded about that game. When we come back, we'll catch up with Jerome Parvater, the head of talent identification at Western Province, and, of course, Maxwell Stoffels. Now, Maxwell was the captain at Belville on the day, and no stranger to the world of rugby at Belville. We'll take an ad break, and then we come straight back to what happened over the weekend. Welcome back, everybody. Remember, you can find us on Facebook, www.facebook.com/CapeRugbyTV. We want you to join us, and we want you to come and say hello to us on Facebook and tell us what is happening. The more you tell us, the more we can tell everybody else about your club. The more people know about your club, the more chance you have to get sponsors. The more chance you have sponsorship, the more you can hold briars and dancers and poiki course. And if you absolutely have to, then you can spend money on the players. But we would prefer to see you spend money on players strapping and pads and things like that. Ish?
No, definitely. Those are the things that the clubs usually try and raise funds for. And they are sometimes hard to get. And yeah. A lot of the players that take it for granted that those things must just appear.
Yeah.
So those things are really, really important to club players.
That's what it means to run a club. You've got to run a club. As an amateur, most people are amateurs who run clubs. They get involved, they do fundraising and all sorts of stuff like that. So if you get any sponsorship money, make sure you look after the club first. You look after the club, you can look after the players. It's like a concept of in the aeroplane, you know, put the mask on the baby first. No, sorry, put the mask on you first.
Yeah, no, look, the club will always be there, the players won't.
Exactly. You got to make the club survive first. We're going to still talk a little bit about membership because we want to see more people sign up to play rugby this year. But let's catch up now with Maxi Stoffels, the captain of Belleville.
Mensen, nou hier so met Maxwell Stoffels, de kaptein van Belleville. Maxwell, ik weet het eerste game voor jullie. Zeker nog een beetje toetsen en zien hoe het gaat gaan voor dit seizoen.
Ja man, het was baie gerust. Maar was een goede ervaring. Ik denk dat we het zo'n game nodig had. Dat is niet de liga waar we ons gaan spelen, maar laat ons zo opgemaakt om in voor ons geweest dat we baie ver achter. Dus, als een goede nederlaag, maar het baie positieve punten ook voor ons, wat ons aan kan werken. So.
Hoeveel practices heb je laag gehad, Adria?
Maar om eerlijk te zijn, was het eerst voor die week, voor de eerste keer samen beginnen oefenen als een span. So, ons was elke keer recht gemotiveerd of recht ingesteld voor die game, maar ik is 100% zeker dat het beter gaan volgende week.
Na één week, so. Dus het is een paar dagen practice. Ja. So, die werk begint nu?
Ons harde week begin, ja. Ons is op de rechte pad. Ik is zeker, mensen kan niet na zo'n verloren. Allemaal uit die bus gewoon. Ik denk, ons moet samen staan. En allemaal kind bij Belleville rugbycultuur. En ons is stadig, maar zeker, ons is jongspannetjes, maak je verskoning zie. Jongspannetjes, maar ons het harde week om uit te komen.
Maar hier die eerste games, dat is niet eindelijk hoe die punten hier. Dat is maar net ja. Om te kijken hoe jullie jol, hoe die spelers samen spelen. Dat is een groot issue nie.
Ja, nee, ik denk, het was 4 of 5 oudjes wat voor de eerste span gespeeld het. En ik denk dat het die ervaring nodig had. En ik denk dat het baie uitgeleerd. Ja. En van ons senior spelers kant af moeten ze erbij staan. En ik zeker volgende week zal het bij beter gaan.
Well, Max, ik weet ons gaf jullie aan een watch. Ja. Wel, we gaan lekker doen. So, best of luck voor de season.
Bye, dankie, Tappy.
Maxi Stoffels there. And by the way, folks, if you want to find the best upholsterer, right, the guys who fixes chairs and couches and things like that, and even makes chairs and then upholsters. Now, I know Max is a teacher. But if you want a really, 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 really good upholsterer at a great price, then, and I know we're turning this into the Cape Rugby TV classifieds, but that's what we do, is we promote our club rugby people, then jump on Facebook and look for Maxi Stoffels. Him and his brother are in the upholstery business, and they do great, great work. So there you go. I must say to Maxi and the guys, they helped me out a while back. And the work is absolutely fantastic, and I must say thanks to you guys. Now, of course, it is Belleville, and it is the Rosina Parvata Stadium, and no interview at Belleville would be complete if we didn't speak to one of the Parvatas. Now, I managed to avoid Chris Parvata on the day because I know that he doesn't like it because I steal his hot dogs, and we managed to catch up with his brother instead, Jerome Parvata, head of talent identification and no stranger to the Cape Rugby TV panel. We caught up with him to find a little bit more about Belleville and what's happening in Western Province rugby.
No stranger to Cape Rugby TV, we're here at Belleville. I'm with Jerome Parvata here at the Rosina Parvata Stadium, the home ground of the Parvata, so to speak. Jerome, ons wonder wanneer gaan ze jou terug op die show kry? I mean, all die travel van jou, jy's seker baie voyage miles.
Ja, definitief, JP, bietjie besig geweest nou die afgelope tyd, maar nou een van die dae weer bietjie rustiger, want die manne kom ons nou in die woude kom Kaap speel, so dan gaan hulle hier bly in die Kaap, so dan travel ek nie meer so baie nie.
Okay, so laat ons vir die mense sê, jy's natuurlik die hoof van talent identification by WP. Die ouens wat hierdie jaar in die WP structures is, wat jy natuurlik laas jaar gekyk het, is jy happy met die vordering?
Ja, definitief JP, verlede Saterdag het almal van hulle gespeel. Had so 12 ouens gespeel verlede Saterdag in die Woudekom span.
Ja.
En baie goed gedoen. Hulle het Boland gewen 65-0. En ja, was 'n lekker skool, was baie warm geweest.
Ja.
Maar was 'n groot skool geweest en die program werk en dit wys net dat die ouens is nou op 'n ander level. En hulle kan meeding vir 'n plek in die woude kom.
Baie van hulle ouens kom van club rugby af.
Almal van hulle is van club rugby af. En hulle was ook nou die week op kamp gewees.
Ja.
En daar is net twee manne wat uitgelaat is van die manne wat van die storms afkom is nou terug wat ook kamp toe is. So dit is goed. Dit wys dat die manne regtig waar die werk ingesit ja. En om 10 manne saam kamp toe te gaan. So hopelik sien ons daar nog meer van die manne speel in die woude kom.
Laastens Belwel is natuurlik vir jou 'n familiespan. Jy kom altyd hier so uit en help vir die ouens. Eerste game vandag, warm-up game. Tel die scoreboard tel jy eintlik veel op vandag soos vandag nie, maar hoe voel jy oor die future hierso?
JP, nee, definitief nie vandag nie. Ek het nie goed gegaan vandag met Belwel nie, maar ek moet sê baie geluk vir Skotsdien.
Ja.
Goeie afgerigte span en jy kan sien hulle het al vroeg beginne werk. Hulle ouens is lekker fiks, hulle het 'n paar groot manne. So ek sien uit na 'n goeie seisoen vir hulle en ek dink ek gaan vir hulle baie dop hou van hulle. Lyk na 'n paar manne wat lekker kan rugby speel daar by hulle. En dan vir Belwel is dit ek dink is nou weer bou van daardie heel wat manne ja. Weggegaan en ou manne het opgehou. So dis 'n bouproses vir hulle en ek dink hulle moet ook maar net aanhou en leer en gewoonlik kom Belwel goed terug. Die manne kom weer van die manne kom weer terug en jy weet hoe gaan dit in klap rugby. So hopelik as die seisoen begin sal hulle weer reg wees.
OK, Jerome, dankie. Maar ek gaan nou hierdie interview shortcut voordat Koos vir my sien. Ons sien jou op die show binnekort, meneer.
OK, JP.
Jerome Parvater, of course, one of our regulars here on Cape Rugby TV. Now, the community challenge is about to start, and this is what everybody's been waiting for now. We did have this discussion earlier on. People still wanted to know, how do the teams, the top four teams, get into the community challenge? Well, it's essentially the top four that finished in Super League A last year that are not a university team or are not playing in the community cup. In other words, Marty's, UCT, and, of course, Hammy's Morgs, and then the other four. Make up the community challenge.
Yeah, that's right. So it's obviously the top seven of the, yeah, of the top yeah. 10 last year.
Let's take a look there at the community challenge groups then, so you can see it clearly in Group A and Group B. And this is, of course, the challenge between Western Province and Boerland. So in Group A, it's Durbel, Horsten, Tigerberg, and Ceres, while in Group B, it's Worcester Villagers, SK Wormwood, Saldanha, and Belhar. All those teams are going to do really well. Let's take a look at the fixtures now. And they're on Saturday. This coming Saturday, you can get down to Ceres. You can watch Ceres take on Durbel. Horsten are up against Tigerberg. They play in Horsten at 4 o'clock. Then Worcester Villagers take on the mighty Belhar in Worcester at 4 o'clock, and Saldanha are up against SK Wormers at 4 o'clock in Saldanha. And then coming up next week, which is closer to home now, and that's what we're looking for, the 8th of March starts the home round for the fixtures. It's, of course, on the A field. There's going to be a lot of action at City Park on the 8th of March. Boerland and Western Province will start off at 1:30, and then Kenya take on EP at 3 o'clock on the A field, while Durbel, which is, of course, now leads towards the main games, Durbel take on Tigerberg at 20:05. And then also on the B field at the same time, we'll see, or just before that actually, we'll see SK Wormers take on Belhar, Worcester takes on Saldanha, and then Horsten takes on Ceres at 12:50. So it's quite a mix there, and I think it's going to be, what I kind of like here is that the provincial teams are almost playing like a curtain raiser yeah. for the club rugby side.
That doesn't often happen,
yeah.
But it's great to see that City Park's going to be the place to be. Jam-packed, six matches. Players coming from Boerland, spectators coming from Boerland, Cape Town. It's going to be absolutely crazy.
It's going to be crazy. But I must just say, you know, people must remember, must actually note, this is not a Boerland Western Province Vodacom fixture. It is actually, well, it is a fixture, but I mean, it's actually about the community challenge and that the professional teams have just come to play.
And just jumped on the bat.
As an add-on, yeah. It's not, okay. You know, people must remember that, and I think that's important to note, that province is making the effort to send the provincial team to the field also, to bring professional rugby to City Park, to support the community challenge, which I think it's a great sign. And not just that, we also see Kenya up against Eastern Province, so Jerome will be happy.
Yeah, there's a semi-international field to it too, so what a festival of rugby. That's next Saturday.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be a cracker. And this is what we've been looking for. We've been waiting for this. Of course, Cape Rugby TV is going to be there. We'll bring you all the action, and we'll bring you a lot more information next week, Wednesday, when we talk about the Community Challenge. So make sure that you start getting ready for City Park on the 8th of March when you get down there to check out some of our, our top four non-university and Community Cup teams. Of course, this weekend, though, it is the Extreme Sevens in Helderberg. We've been talking about a lot about this for about 4 months now. 52 teams and 42 leagues, under 13s, under 18s, ladies and seniors. It starts on Friday, so you can get down there this Friday, and then ends on Saturday. There is 100,000 rand prize money up for grabs. Winner takes all. Okay, so you want to get down there now already, and you'll see it. There is 100,000 rand of prize money. It's 50,000 rand for the club that wins, 25,000 rand for the primary school that wins, and 25,000 rand for the high school that wins. So lots of prize money in action up for grabs, and there's going to be lots of entertainment. So the first games, I think they're going to start at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They carry on through to 8 o'clock. There's bands and poiki course competitions. So it is, of course, the Helderberg's Extreme Sevens this coming weekend, starting on Friday, finishing on Saturday night. So make sure you get down there if you're in the area and really enjoy yourselves. It's going to be great, great fun. We'll take an ad break, and when we come back, we'll turn our attention to Super 15. So yeah, the Super 15 has kicked off. Now we're in the second round. I think from our point of view, it's only just kicked off because the Stormers had their first game over the weekend. I know there's been lots of warm-up games, and the first round was a little bit up and down. But I think one of the things that we're seeing, and I'm going to get my experts to comment on the results here. But let's first take a look at the results there in the second round of the Super 15. The Crusaders, well, they went down to the Chiefs 18 points to 10. The Cheetahs 15-9 over the Bulls. The Brumbies 27-17. They went down against the Reds, and the Sharks 27-9 over the Hurricanes. And the Lions 34-10 over the Stormers. And then the Waratahs 43 points to 21 over the Force. Now, I'm not going to talk about the fact that I destroyed all of you in the Super Brew predictions again. But a couple of upsets. Morgs?
Yeah, obviously.
Okay, well, let me ask you, put it you this way. Do you think that the Chiefs-Crusaders match was an upset? Except for yourself.
It's a tough one. I don't think it was an upset. I think the Chiefs are, they for the last 3 years have really been doing well. So I put my money on them, and I think I got the result.
Yeah, okay, well done. at least you got one. Ish, yourself?
Crusaders always start very slow.
Yeah, we agree on that. Huh?
We agree on that. So they'll pick it up in the next couple of weeks.
Cheetahs, Bulls, I pretty much expected the Cheetahs to beat the Bulls. I don't think the Bulls are what they're cut out for. They've got Victor Matfield in there, so obviously scraping the barrel a bit.
Yeah, the Bulls are going through a transition phase. But it's a tough time for the Bulls, but they'll turn around. They've lost their captain, Pierce Smith, so they've got some serious soul searching to do.
There's some serious injuries running around the Super 15 at the moment, Ish.
Well, Pierre's out for about 6 months. They're going to have to search for a new leader now. Maybe Victor will step in.
Yeah, they probably won't have to search too far then. Always someone who's retired and might make a comeback. But I would hate to be the guy that sold Victor Pierce Spice's injury insurance.
he's been through a rough patch, but yeah, look, the Bulls will turn it around, no doubt. You know, they're too good a side to not do it.
Why would the Bulls turn it around, Morgs?
Because, you know, 2 games in the trot, they've now got the feel of things. They've got a new captain, they'll do some soul-searching, they'll regroup, and they'll get the result.
The Bulls have lost too many experienced players. It's Mornay Steyn, Fernand Olafi, the list just goes on.
But at least the one thing is there that we can say is that they've managed to lose Zane Kushner. Finally.
Zane Kushner was a good player.
All right.
He still is. I just think that the Bulls are in a rebuilding phase at the moment. And that they should be hitting their straps, hopefully, in the next couple of weeks. Frans Ludwig is a very good coach. He comes with a good track record. And
are you a closet Bulls supporter, both of you guys? I mean, do you what's with all this Bulls love, Morgs?
Yeah, no, I don't know. They're a South African team, I suppose. I still support them, eh, Jace?
Yeah, but we're in the South African conference now at the moment. So don't worry if they're a South African team. You're allowed to dislike the enemy. If they're playing against the Crusaders, then you can then you can say, no, well, we have to support the Bulls.
Well, they're still South African. Only when they play the Stormers, then we can change
it. Then the hatred will kick in.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. The hatred. Okay. That's a little bit strong. That's a little bit strong. Okay, we're having a bit of fun in games here. Anyway, the Brumbies, of course, up against the Reds. And the Jake White factor, losing Jake White, was that a factor, Morse?
I definitely think so. I think that you could see that. I mean, Jake White, you know, from going to title contenders last year to losing to the Reds, who did fairly poorly last year as well.
Yeah.
No, it's a bad result for them, and I think they'll turn it around.
And the Reds are looking a little bit better than they did last year?
Yeah, Cooper and Guinea, they're world-class.
Yeah.
And if they start getting front football, it's unstoppable.
All right. I don't know if I made the right Super Bowl prediction then this week, but we're going to get into that in a second. Of course, the Sharks beat the Hurricanes, and then the Lions against the Stormers. I know that the fans are desperately upset about the fact that the Stormers lost. It is the Stormers' first game.
Yeah.
The Lions were always going to come out guns blazing. They've had themselves humiliated and embarrassed for the last year and a half with this whole Super 15 debacle. It was never going to be easy, but you don't win the Super 15 in the first round.
Fully agree, and I just think that the performance as a whole, I think that's what the fans are really sort of upset about. We don't mind losing, but in terms of performance-wise, I don't think the guys were up there. And we can't always make the excuse that it's our first game and stuff like that.
Well, I'm glad you said that because, you know, Jean de Villiers, the captain, actually said after the game he was disgusted in the performance, which means that he was not looking for excuses. So I must give credit when they know they've played badly, they actually said they played badly.
Well, he's the national captain. He's allowed to say something like that. And the guys will sort of respect him when he says that. And he was very honest in his post-match interview. And hopefully, I can guarantee you they will lift it up come Friday night.
I almost there were moments in the game that I thought maybe the guys were just trying too hard. You know, that they were trying to get the passes to get to the next player, and the passes were going too fast to the player's hands, and then there was a bit of ball fumbling going on. And I thought really that maybe they were too excited to hit the Super 15 and needed to calm down a little bit more composure. It's going to be interesting to see how they go over the next few weeks.
I don't know. Well, Skalk Berger, apparently we've lost him, I don't know, for this week. So he's another major leader that's gone.
Yeah.
Hopefully, Jean and the rest of the leaders will pick it up, Dwayne and them. I'm sure they will.
I think we're going to see a couple of interesting moves there. Possibly Damian D'Allender might move back into center. Jakub Tauta is apparently back at fullback. Gio Aplon will probably then move back onto the wing. So there's going to be... De Kock Steenkamp apparently is also challenging to get back into the lock spot. Mm. So there's going to be, I can't wait to see Ollie Kebble, this new guy they say destroys absolutely everybody. Anyway, let's quickly look at the Super 15 fixtures. It's the Blues against the Crusaders, the Rebels and the Cheetahs, the Stormers, the Hurricanes, the Chiefs, the Highlanders, Waratahs and the Reds, the Force, the Brumbies, the Bulls and the Lions. Of course, the big one for us this weekend is the Stormers up against the Hurricanes. Kickoff at 7 o'clock on Friday night. So those are Friday night games, folks. Let's look now at the Evox Advanced Nutrition Competition. So if you want to win for yourself an Evox Advanced Nutrition Hamper before, during and after, there you can see what you need to do. Who is the official sports nutrition supplier to Western Province Rugby and the GHL Stormers? Just SMS to answer to 33280. Congratulations to last week's winner, Leslie April. So Leslie April, you win for yourself the Rapid Recovery, as you saw on the screen there now. You win the Super Carbo and the Cyto Crank. All right, so Leslie, well done there to Leslie April, who walks away with the before, the during, and the after hamper. Right, so that's what you need to do. This is the before, the Cyto Crank, this is the during, the Super Carbo, and this is the Rapid Recovery. You want to win this hamper, just get your cell phone out and SMS to 33280. There you'll see it on your screen right now. 33280 is the number that you're looking for. 33280 is the number that you're looking for. 33280, there you see it on your screen right now. There we go. There you see it on your screen right now. SMS to answer to 33280. And once again, congratulations there to Leslie April. Before, during, and after hamper from Evox is on its way to you. Let's take a quick look at how the top 10 is looking in our Super Brew pool. Zell is on top there with the yellow cap. Pitman, Jean-Pierre, Flash Craig, Best Beer. Well done to Craig. We know him from NNK. Murdoch, Mushaman, Riffy, Jason, Charlie, and Jay. I dropped out of that one. Anyway, it was a rough call for me, but I was in the top 10 until I think one of the last games. And then let's quickly look then at the Super Brew predictions. We'll start off with Morgan Newman. It's the Blues and the Crusaders. Morgs.
Crusaders 12.
Ish.
Crusaders 10.
I'm going with the Crusaders by 9. The Rebels and the Cheetahs. Morgs.
I'm going to go Cheetahs 5.
Cheetahs 8.
I'm going to go with the Rebels by 6. And then the Stormers take on the Hurricanes at Newlands. Morgs.
Stormers 3.
ish.
Stormers 15.
All right, Stormers 15. I'm going to go with the Stormers by 5. And then the Chiefs take on the Highlanders, playing in Hamilton. It's going to be a tough one there for the Highlanders. The Chiefs, I'll go with by 5. Morgs.
It's a tough one. Chiefs 1.
Chiefs 3.
Chiefs have not won yet, but I'll give it to you. Ish going with the Chiefs by 3. And then the Waratahs take on the Reds. Morgs.
Well, another tough one. Reds 7.
Waratahs 5.
A little bit of a ishy-ishy there, eh, between the two of you. I'm going to go with the Waratahs by 6. The Force take on the Brumbies. They're playing in Perth, so it's going to be home ground advantage for the Force. Morgs.
Brumbies 12.
Ish.
Brumbies 10.
I'm going to go with the Brumbies by 8. And then, of course, in Pretoria, you'll see the mighty Bulls with a scavenging, revenging, and returning Victor Matfield as they look to pulverize the Lions at home ground. The Bulls and the Lions in Pretoria on Saturday. Morgs. This is a one-day game.
Lions 3.
Bulls 5.
Yeah. You see, I go back to what we were saying earlier on. Oh my word, I'm going to go with the Bulls by 4. Alright, so the Bulls, even though I was so anti-Bulls earlier on, I still think that the Bulls can pull one off against the Lions. They certainly are going to be looking to bounce back. That's a wrap of our Cape Rugby TV show. Folks, remember, the Stormers are at Newlands on Friday, kickoff at 7 o'clock. And then, of course, don't forget the Community Cup games on Saturday as well. Very, very exciting. And then next week, from the 8th of March, you can catch the Community Challenge, which is happening here at City Park. It's going to be a monster entertaining event. You make sure Cape Rugby TV is there as well. And then don't forget the Helderberg Sevens starting on Friday, finishing on Saturday. Very exciting. Morgan Newman, have a good rugby weekend.
Thanks, Chaps. You too.
Ish, thanks for joining us.
Thanks a lot, Chaps.
Here we go, folks. We'll see you again next week, same time, same place. And remember, the repeat is on at 9 o'clock on Saturday, DSTV, channel 263. Bye-bye.